Welcome, everyone. I'm Mandana Khalili, Professor of Medicine and the Director of the UCSF Research Coordinating Center Investigator Development Unit of the NIMHD Multiple Chronic Diseases Consortium. I'd like to welcome you to our monthly training webinar. Before we start, we would like to acknowledge the Ramaytush Ulani people who are the traditional custodians of this land. We pay our respects to the Ramaytush Ulani elders, past, present, and future, who call this place the land that UCSF sits upon, their home. We're proud to continue the tradition of coming together and growing as a community. We thank the Ramaytush Ulani community for their stewardship and support, and we look forward to strengthening our ties as we continue our relationship of mutual respect and understanding. Well, today, we are honored to have Drs. Rachel Shelton and Natalie Moise introducing us to implementation science theories, models, and frameworks. Dr. Rachel Shelton is a social and behavioral scientist with training in cancer and social epidemiology. She has expertise in implementation science, sustainability, health equity, and community-based participatory research. She's an associate professor of social medical sciences at Columbia University's Mailman School of Public Health, where she is a co-director of the Community Engagement Core Resource and the director of an implementation science initiative through the Irving Institute for Clinical and Translational Research. Dr. Shelton developed one of the first courses offered in implementation science and has been an invited speaker and a mentor for our implementation science programs and training globally for over 10 years. Next, we have Dr. Natalie Moise. She's an internist and Florence Irving Associate Professor of Medicine at Columbia University Irving Medical Center and the director of the Center for Behavioral Cardiovascular Health Implementation Science Lab. She's conducted health services research for more than 10 years and serves as a PI or co-PI of several federally funded implementation science grants that uses hybrid effectiveness implementation designs to test behavioral activation, patient preference, and shared decision-making using digital health interventions, both in primary care and cardiology settings. Before we start the presentation, I'd like to remind us that please do not hesitate to submit questions through chat. I will be monitoring the chat and we'd be happy to ask those questions of our presenters at the end of their presentations. And we will have an opportunity as well for individuals who would like to speak out at the end as well. Welcome, Drs. Shelton and Moise. We look forward to your presentation.
Thank you so much for having us and this introduction. I'm thrilled to be here. Can everyone see my screen? Is that okay? Perfect.
Yes. Great.
So thank you. This is a topic that is very near and dear to my heart. And Natalie and I actually work very closely on both research projects and a lot of capacity building at Columbia together in this area. And we also co-lead a lot of the implementation methods work for the P50 Community Center, the network that many of you are part of, funded through NIMHD. So thrilled to be here to co-present. Okay, I want to kick us off. We have a lot of information to cover. We're not going to be able to monitor the chat, but again, reach out to us, and I hope we have some time at the end for big picture questions as well. So I don't want to assume everyone knows a lot about implementation science. I want to make sure we're all on the same page because some people may be newer to the field. So implementation science is a field that has really developed over the past 20 years in recognition of the very well-documented gap between research, you know, all of our evidence-based interventions and programs and practices and treatments that we invest in and that we know work for health, improving health, and then practice. What's actually routinely and widespread delivered in most real-world clinical and community and public health settings? So implementation science is all about that translation and all about the how. How do we do this? What are the approaches, the methods, and the frameworks and theories that we'll be talking about today that can really actively promote that widespread adoption and that actual integration into the settings, particularly among the populations that face many structural and social barriers to health? When we think about where implementation science falls, you know, increasingly implementation scientists are starting to work much earlier along this translational continuum as we're developing that evidence base. But I think it's important to recognize kind of historically where we think about it along the translational continuum. There often already is an evidence-based program or guideline. And again, this is really about the how. How do we actually get it implemented on a much broader scale in a lot of the real-world practice settings that haven't been reached? And so again, a lot of the focus, this is a nice model that Enola Proctor and colleagues have developed. Again, we often are starting with the evidence-based intervention. Maybe it's a, you know, lay health advisor program. Maybe it's a multi-level clinical intervention that involves a decision aid. And we are really often focusing on that how. What are the strategies to actually get that into practice? And what's different from a lot of the effectiveness studies is that a lot of our outcomes, our implementation outcomes, are a bit more proximal. So if we're doing a study across a healthcare system with 40 clinics, we might be looking at things like adoption, fidelity, cost, sustainability. And some of those health outcomes or clinical outcomes might be part of that, but they might be more secondary. So again, that's a bit about what the field is focused on. And so now we're going to talk about all of the many, many theories and frameworks that we have in the field available to actually rigorously promote and advance this work. So many of you, you know, I was trained in social and behavioral sciences. And so historically, I was really used to, you know, a lot of our health behavioral and social theories, things like social cognitive theory that we might use to inform interventions. And so it's similar in implementation science, but I want to say what's different is that we have a lot more types of theories and frameworks that we apply for a lot of different areas of our research. So just like a lot of our other social behavioral theories, theories and frameworks in implementation science are really useful in informing, you know, everything about our design, our evaluation, our measurement, our analysis. It's often very well integrated. It can enhance what we're actually, how we're actually trying to implement, right? It can enhance our understanding of barriers and facilitators to plan for dissemination and implementation. Ideally, it can also help us get at some of the mechanisms of change. Why did this strategy work or not work in this specific new context where we're trying to implement? What's the how? It can also help with increasing and advancing replication. It provides a common and shared terminology, assumptions, definitions that the field can call upon. And ideally, that can really be used to help advance the science and enhance some of the transparency and generalizability of our findings as we're learning. There's a nice paper that Enola Proctor and Ross Brownson and colleagues wrote on what are some of the successful ingredients of funded implementation science grants. And one of the most important things we see in study section for implementation science is that successful grants really integrate theories and frameworks from implementation science, not just in one little section of the grant, but they're very well integrated across the aims, across the methods, across the measures, and it informs really all of the decisions we often make in our implementation science work. I also want to say, while I think our theories and frameworks are a useful foundation and starting point, they are far from perfect. It's often much less prescriptive than a lot of the theories and frameworks we often involve and use in social behavioral theory. There's a lot more creativity and opportunities for innovation. Okay. Another thing I want to say is there are important distinctions between theories, models, and frameworks. So frameworks are often much more descriptive. They might be lists of factors. Models might start to get at some of the relationships between those constructs and factors, whereas theories start to really get at some of the how and the why and the mechanisms. And I want to say the field has not been that specific. These terms, theories, models, and frameworks are often used kind of interchangeably. And today I will mostly be using the term frameworks, but I just want to recognize there is a distinction there. The other thing I'll say, you know, I've been doing a lot of work over the past 10 years in teaching this, and, you know, Natalie and I both do a lot of consultations in implementation science for implementation science grants. And I think probably the most common question that we get is around the theories, models, and frameworks. People often really don't understand, how do you select the right one? How am I applying it? Can I mix and match? And I think part of the confusion has been that, you know, the field developed quite rapidly and developed across a range of fields, right? So it's developed in education and healthcare and public health. It's very transdisciplinary. So we have seen just a huge proliferation of theories, models, and frameworks in the field. We have almost 200 that have been documented. So that is one of the challenge. You will see, you know, people tend to use the same one in their work. They get familiar with it. But I want to encourage us, we're going to introduce you to a wide range of theories, models, and frameworks today with the hope that people can start to innovate in some new areas and start to get creative in how we're applying them to advance the field. I do want to say that I found it really useful. There's certain ways that people think about different types of theories and models and frameworks for different reasons. So Pierre Nielsen has a really nice paper that lays out process frameworks, determinant frameworks, classic theory frameworks that really get at implementation mechanisms, evaluation frameworks. So this is one way we can think about how we go about selecting is, what is the purpose of the framework for our implementation research? What aspect is it guiding? Today, my goal is not to do a deep dive of all 170, and I don't think it's that useful to just focus on a couple. So I'm going to give you a high-level overview of four or five of the different categories of types of theories, models, and frameworks we have, and highlight a couple within that. That'll be in the first 30 minutes, and then Natalie's going to do a deeper dive with some really nice applied examples from her work. I just want to say there's been a number of papers that have kind of outlined the range of these types of theories, models, and frameworks. I mentioned the Nielsen one. A more recent one that came out is by Laura Dam Schroeder. I love the title, which I think captures the state of this field, Clarity Out of Chaos. So this is a nice updated one too, that again uses these different categories that I'm going to go through today to illustrate how these can be applied and how we might think about them in different combinations for different reasons. Okay. So let's start with our determinant frameworks. These are very, very commonly used in the field. And our determinant frameworks really are used to help do that initial contextual assessment to really guide our understanding of what's happening in the context where we'll be implementing to inform our efforts. So context is just a huge focus. You hear the word context often in the field of implementation science. It's kind of a foundation of what we're seeking to understand. So the determinant frameworks have us really think about these multi-level aspects of context that might matter for implementation. What I think is a little bit different is that often our contextual assessment, as we're doing this work, we often are looking at multiple levels. So our assessment of barriers and facilitators might be among patients or community members. They might be among the implementers, the providers, the lay health advisors. They might also be among the administrators, the leadership, the policymakers. So it's common that we would use these determinant frameworks to guide our understanding of what are those multi-level barriers and facilitators at multiple levels from these various community stakeholder perspectives. Here is one of the most commonly used determinant frameworks. You probably have heard of it, the Consolidated Framework for Implementation Research, or CFIR. It was developed by Laura Dam Schroeder in 2009. And I think it's important to recognize it was developed in the context of a clinical setting in the VA, the Veterans Affairs Administration. So it is very clinical focused in terms of the factors it thinks about. So the CFIR has five core kind of domains in which 30 some constructs fall within it. So it thinks about, in terms of understanding context, it thinks about the outer setting, which is really often defined as that policy or maybe that system setting, depending on the level at which you're intervening. So it could be the policies, the legal or regulatory policies or practices, the incentives that are in place in terms of Medicare or Medicaid reimbursement. It thinks about the norms within a system. So if you have 40 clinics, what are the norms in terms of the leaders or what the pressure might be to implement or not? It thinks about that network, that in terms of how they are interconnected. And it also thinks about, to a small extent, the patient needs and resources and their characteristics and how that might influence implementation. At the inner setting, that's often really that organizational unit in which we're implementing. It's the hospital, the clinic, the school, the worksite, the church. And it gets at the structural characteristics, all those factors around the organizational climate and culture, the organizational readiness. How ready is it for implementation? What are the networks? Who are the champions who might be in place? What are the leadership's perceptions on implementation? What's the infrastructure available? It also gets at processes. You can see here with that arrow, those implementation processes. What are all those things that are in place? The evaluation, the planning, the reflection or executing, all those implementation processes that might already be in place that might influence your implementation effort. It looks at the characteristics of the evidence-based intervention. So let's say it's a lay health advisor program, right? What's the source of the evidence for that? What's the advantage over what's being done already? How complex is it? What's the cost? And it also gets at the characteristics of the individuals, but it's really focusing on the characteristics of the implementers. What's their knowledge, attitudes, beliefs, motivation? So this is a sense. So you can see here, that's kind of a visual depiction. These are kind of the constructs within each of these five domains. There is an excellent website, cforguide.org, that has just so many tools that are useful and really great examples of research in this area. I also want to say Laura Damschroeder released a CFER 2.0, a new version that will be coming out anytime now. And I will say I have kind of seen her present that work. And the main change, I would say, is that she provides additional clarification and a couple additional constructs where it wasn't, she felt like, or where researchers felt like certain important aspects weren't being captured. So for example, she adds the source or the credibility or trustworthiness of the source of evidence as an additional construct. So stay tuned, that's not quite available yet, but not a huge departure from this original model. So how do people use this? What does this look like in research? And again, there's some really nice examples, including work led by Laura herself that is available. One way that people have done this is to really use a mixed methods approach to data collection up front to understand potentially some of the differences across higher implementing sites, moderate implementation sites, and sites that are really struggling with implementation. And trying to understand the extent to which these different constructs within the domains might differ or might be more important or less important in influencing implementation. So she has a whole guiding kind of a rating system that looks at the valence or the strength of the constructs within each of those domains. So that's kind of a more rigorous or kind of sophisticated application of it. There's lots of other examples of it being applied to really inform a lot of the qualitative formative work that might happen up front as well. So I've put some examples here of both qualitative and some emerging quantitative work and survey work and measurement that's coming out. But to date, there's not kind of a tool or measurement assessment of all the constructs. One way that we have used it, so we had a CTSA funded grant to really look at using CFER to inform understanding of both student, administrator, and staff understandings of all the barriers and facilitators to implementing naloxone training and opioid education on undergraduate campuses. So the way we used it was not prescriptive, but really as a starting place. It really informed, those domains informed a lot of our initial questions that we asked. And then we used some of the constructs within it as probes to go a little bit deeper. So that's a common way that people might use CFER to inform their formative work to inform implementation efforts. That is kind of an introduction to CFER. I know Natalie's gonna tap a little bit more into that. There are other determinant frameworks that are quite similar to CFER. Another one is PRISM, the PRISM model developed by Russ Glasgow and colleagues. I would say, again, it looks at a lot of these same organizational, policy, implementer, and evidence-based characteristics. One of the differences here is it goes a little bit deeper into the patient perspective that is not as well reflected on CFER. So for example, it gets at the extent to which the intervention is patient-centered and addresses specific patient barriers. And it's, again, very clinical focused, very patient focused. So again, this is another nice example of one that's commonly used to plan for and understand contextual factors for implementation. So what do we do with that information? And again, Nally's going to go deeper into this, but the whole point of doing, of using these determinant frameworks to understand these multi-level barriers and facilitators is to really then think about, how are we addressing those barriers? What are the implementation strategies that can map onto those barriers, right? So if it's issues around motivation of clinicians, for example, how might an implementation strategy around incentives be able to address that? If it's about, you know, really, you know, limited knowledge among providers or implementers, an implementation strategy might relate to training or education. So again, that contextual assessment and those determinant frameworks can really help shape the strategies that we're going to be testing and refining and evaluating through our implementation research. There are a lot of problems with our existing determinant frameworks that I just want to note. So it's important to note that most of these were developed in healthcare settings. They often do not really reflect community or social context. Many have not been validated or tested in low and middle income countries. A lot of them don't focus on specific equity focused determinants, particularly among patients or community members. And a lot of them are descriptive. They don't tell you how or why to act on this information. So there are limitations. I want to say there's some exciting innovations happening in this area. There's been some modifications of CFER, for example, to address some of the limitations of reflecting low and middle income countries. There's been ones that have been applied in learning health systems. There's been some that have been applied to address much more of a racism lens and approach. We are actually in our P50 testing some different versions of CFER to kind of advance work in this area. So I think there's a lot of room for adaptation and refinement. Okay, so that's the determinant frameworks. Now let's think a little bit about the evaluation frameworks in implementation science. And these, again, we were talking about kind of the upfront piece. These are really informing our indicators, our implementation outcomes that we will be tracking. So REAIM is a common evaluation framework developed by Russ Glasgow and colleagues 20 years ago. And again, the goal of REAIM was to move away from this singular focus we tend to have just on internal validity and effectiveness, and really think about external validity and think about the extent to which different populations and settings are able to adopt or implement or not. So it really leads us through reach, which patients are reached, why and why not. Is it still effective now that we are delivering this in a real world setting? What are the unintended consequences? Which settings are able to adopt or not and why? What's the extent to which the program is fully delivered and what are the costs associated with that? And then maintenance, what's the extent to which this continues to be delivered and sustained over time? Again, just like CFER, there is a wonderful website that has so many tools, both practical and research-oriented for REAIM. There's a really nice 20-year review that Russ Glasgow and colleagues did last year that provides great examples and updates. So there's a lot of resources to inform your work in this area. In my work, I was concerned that REAIM often wasn't explicit enough about being really transparent about when and where the health inequities in particular were arising at both the setting and patient levels. So with David Chambers and Russ Glasgow, we extended the REAIM model to have a greater focus on tracking when and where along the implementation continuum inequities arise or existing inequities are exacerbated. So this is published in Frontiers Public Health. It has a great guide in terms of qualitative work and metrics that you can use to inform each of these REAIM indicators with an equity focus. It's common as well, you know, we talked about CFER and REAIM. It's very common to combine different implementation science frameworks together within the same research proposal. So here's a really nice example by Diane King and colleagues on what it might mean to track REAIM, look at all the indicators, but then also track and assess CFER to understand which of the constructs within CFER might be most relevant or important to address at these different phases and domains of REAIM. So again, very common to think about these in combination and some nice examples of that. The other implementation outcome or evaluation indicator framework that's commonly used in the field is the Proctor model that I mentioned at the start. And again, This is often just used to cite what we might think about as important implementation indicators in our work. So we can see that here, things like feasibility, acceptability, sustainability, uptake, and costs. Okay, so that's on the evaluation frameworks. Now I'm going to move on to some of the process frameworks. So again, these are different in that these will guide you a little bit more on the actual processes and roadmap for implementation. There are a lot of frameworks that have been developed in the field on adaptation. It is a tremendous and huge area of interest in the field of implementation science. Some of these frameworks really help you track which types of adaptations have been made to understand the impact they have on effectiveness or implementation, things like the frame and frame IS that Shannon Wolsey-Sturman and others have developed, whereas others really guide your implementation and adaptation process. Let's say you have an evidence-based intervention, but it was not developed for the population or setting you're working with. So adapt it, for example, as one model really guides you through the process of adaptation. Gina Wingood is a mentor and faculty member at Columbia, and she has done just amazing work. This has been used almost 1,000 times in the published literature, the adaptive model, widely used both in the context of HIV and other health issues. So again, you could imagine you could use a determinants framework to plan for implementation while still using an adaptation model to inform the process of adaptation that your intervention might need. So you can imagine these could work synergetically together. The other example of a process model is something like the knowledge to action model or the transcreation framework. Again, these lead you through a little bit step by step of how to go about the implementation process. One example, Natalie Parisa Taranafar and I have an NCI funded R01 where we're using the knowledge to action framework to guide our implementation process in terms of assessing barriers, working with stakeholders, then using that information to inform our strategies for de-implementation, and then really using that to then track which implementation indicators are important to stakeholders. So really leading us through this whole process and in combination with something like the dual process model, which is kind of a more traditional theory. And that theory is really having us think about what type of strategy might be really important, ones that both are kind of learner guided as well as those that are more autonomic and system based. So again, you can imagine using these in different combinations. Okay. We also have hybrid frameworks. There are not many of these, but a couple of frameworks guide both your understanding of barriers and facilitators to implementation, but they might also have you think about the different phases of implementation. So one example is a model and framework developed by Greg Ahrens, the EPIS framework, which has you really think about maybe there are certain factors or determinants that matter mostly for that exploration phase, mostly for that implementation phase, or mostly for that sustainability phase. So again, an excellent resource, the episframework.org website has lots of tools and resources to guide you in this. And Greg is doing some really interesting work applying this across really mental health systems at the policy level. So some great examples of this work. So that's a lot about the different types and how we might select the theory model or framework based on the type of work that we're doing and the phase of implementation. I also want to mention there are whole theories and frameworks in the field that focus on different aspects of the process. So we've talked a lot about adaptation and implementation. There are also frameworks that focus on the dissemination. How do we get it in the hands of those key decision makers? And sustainability. How do we sustain it once it's initially been implemented? So there are also theories and frameworks that have us think about what's the best way for us to communicate our evidence to those key decision makers or policy makers. So an example is the diffusion of innovation theory by Everett Rogers. There's some really innovative work that colleagues, Jonathan Pertle and others are doing that uses diffusion of innovation to really shape the messaging and the dissemination strategies that are used to ultimately impact policymakers and their adoption of policies and laws that are evidence-based. So you can think about how could we frame and understand their values in terms of the cost, the advantage, the simplicity of the evidence, and how can we then frame our messaging to impact their adoption of this evidence. So again, some really nice examples, especially at the policy level, happening here. And this is, of course, Everett Rogers' Diffusion of Innovation book. I want to say this area has been very underdeveloped in implementation science. Much of the work has happened on implementation. So I think this is a key area and opportunity. Another way that we have seen this is people have looked at the adoption curve, the diffusion curve, and thought about who within the network is an early adopter. People have used things like social network analysis or ethnographic work to identify them and think about what is the impact if we get the early adopter or that opinion leader on board in terms of accelerating the adoption of this evidence-based intervention within the system or network. So again, some great opportunities here to think about application of diffusion of innovation. I'm going to go through this quickly just to say, I just have a few minutes left and I want to hand it over to Natalie. But I want to say there's also, you know, whole areas of work on sustainability. I have a whole study funded just on developing and testing a framework for sustainability in the context of lay health advisor programs nationally. There's lots of work that David Chambers and others have done on these notions of dynamic sustainability. So if you're interested in sustainability in particular, there are some great resources and readings that I have put in the slides that we will share. Okay. So a couple areas that I think are novel, Natalie's going to go into one of them, but I want to say are a little bit distinct with implementation science. One of them is the area of organizational change and organizational readiness. Sarah Birkin, Greg Ahrens, and others have done a lot of work kind of building off of the psychology and the organizational management literature. So I've put some readings here if you're really interested in thinking about organizational leadership change and organizational readiness. Natalie's going to be talking in just a minute about some of the work with the theoretical domains framework and the behavior change wheel that's happened that gets much more at moving beyond just the descriptive determinants and really thinking about how we're influencing implementation through our strategies. So she's going to talk more about that as well. But I think these are two kind of novel areas where people are bringing in more traditional theories and developing new ones in the context of implementation science. So what I'd encourage you to think about, you know, as you're making decisions about theories, models, and frameworks in implementation science, I just want to say there is no one right one to select, right? There's no perfect ones. There's lots of options. But think about the fit, your comfort, and how does it fit with either the stage of research in which you're applying it or the work you're hoping to advance. So think about your research question. In your application, again, it's very common to mix and match for different purposes, right? That is very common. But just make sure you're really clear and you're streamlined and communicating on how they're synergistic and how you're applying for what purpose. And I also want to encourage you, there are so many opportunities, I think, just like you've seen here on some of the refinements, there's lots of ways to think about being creative, innovating, and advancing the science. A lot of these theories, models, and frameworks were developed in very specific clinical settings. And I think we have an opportunity in particular to really bring in some of the historical work on theories and frameworks that have addressed health equity and do a better job with that. So those are some gaps and opportunities in the field. There's been, you know, really an emerging area with health equity frameworks and implementation science. There's some great work that's looking at issues of power. There's work on adapting existing frameworks with an equity focus to address issues of, you know, stigma and mistrust, racism and discrimination, some work on intersectionality. So I've put examples here. All of these have come out in the last 3 to 4 years. So I want to say there's a lot more work that can be done in actually applying them and empirically testing and learning. Okay, I'm gonna pass it over to Natalie. I will say just one example in terms of how we are doing this, just so you have an example from an existing kind of large study. So I'm part of a P50 network at Penn, an implementation science center, and I lead the health equity methods core. And we are really developing and testing different behavioral economic strategies to inform uptake of different forms of evidence-based programs in the context of cancer. And in the context of this study, again, we're using three theories and frameworks. We're using the health equity implementation model because we felt like CFIR alone was not sufficient. So we're using both of those as part of our kind of determinants piece. And then we're using the re-aim extension to inform our outcomes and our indicators. So you can see here where we're looking at evaluating our mechanisms in terms of whether or not the strategies worked or not. This is informed by both CFIR and the health equity implementation framework. And our outcomes here are informed by re-aim. So that's an example of how this might come together in combination. Okay, I'm gonna hand it over to Natalie.
Amazing, thank you. That was excellent. So you can go one back so that I can just give some context for people. Well, that's okay. I could actually get started. That's okay. Oh, perfect. So I'll be focusing mostly on the application here in terms of really using some of the work from my different R01s on how I've been able to kind of validate and apply these theories, frameworks, and models and get a better understanding of the use cases where it's appropriate or not appropriate to use different types of frameworks. Next slide. So we have a scientific statement coming out that's in press where we're really focused on for lay audiences, really getting a better understanding of how to use these theories, frameworks, and models in the area of cardiovascular disease equity. So really, I'm going to try to synthesize everything that Rachel just said in terms of the different areas that we use these frameworks, just to give you a final overview of how you can use this for a specific use case. So usually we're starting with, is there an evidence-based intervention, hopefully in a vulnerable, does it work in vulnerable populations? And if it does, is it being delivered adequately and equally? And if it's not, you're really, this is where we actually get started in implementation science. There's a research to practice gap, and we're trying to understand why or why not that gap actually exists. So I'll take you through some areas and where you can apply theories, models, and frameworks to understand the why or why not to help you develop, implement, and then evaluate a strategy. Next slide. So our evidence-based interventions that we're really focused on are really in the area of behavioral cardiology. Our group has really focused on elucidating the relationship between negative health behaviors and stress and depression on heart disease. And there are a slew of evidence-based interventions that have now emerged. We know that depression treatment, counseling, stress management improve outcomes. And we're really, really interested in the kind of team-based, more complex evidence-based interventions like cardiac rehab, which improves both mental health and physical outcomes. I'm in collaborative care, which I've really been focused on. It's one of the few evidence-based interventions that has been shown to reduce disparities, mental health disparities, to improve stigma, to improve indices of discrimination, for example. But of course, it's not being very widely implemented. Next slide. So this is what Rachel talked about. So the first big piece of like, why aren't these evidence-based interventions being implemented? And so what we've done, and this is a good example of ways you can combine frameworks that, as Rachel talked about. So she talked about CFIR. And so really some of the salient components of CFIR are the community level, the outer setting, the external policies, incentive components, as well as healthcare system. What kind of healthcare, is your healthcare system amenable to this type of evidence-based intervention? Are there other priorities? What's the tension for change in terms of improving the uptake of this evidence-based intervention? Meanwhile, other frameworks like the theoretical domains framework, which Rachel also touched on, is really much more focused on the ways in which patient and provider behavior, so their motivation, I just don't want to do this no matter what, no matter how evidence-based it is, nothing will convince me. I don't believe that it would improve outcomes. Maybe there's lack of reinforcement, for example, and capability, which is really focused on, oh, I didn't even know about this intervention, lack of knowledge, memory and attention, especially providers, you're so busy. Lots of these kind of more behavioral constructs of getting an understanding of what's driving behavior. And so my former postdoc, now assistant professor, Andrea Duran, combined these two frameworks, and there's been now precedent for, you still have to make an argument in grants, for example, of why you're combining determinant frameworks. But there have been a couple publications now stating that making the case for the ways in which it really allows you to comprehensively understand the determinants of a behavior, not just focus on behavior, but also focus on all of the kind of resources, inner and outer settings as well. Next slide. So she applied this to cardiac rehab. So we know cardiac rehab is evidence-based, and there's been some literature that it can be delivered in the clinic, but it can also be delivered at home as well. And so this is a very nice example of the ways in which combining the frameworks really allows you to really understand the drivers. So for clinic-based cardiac rehab, you can see that much of the determinants, most of the barriers around the time of COVID were really outer and inner setting barriers. It's really around social distancing and inability to conduct group visits and lack of physical space. And I've highlighted and read the ways we've started thinking about equity here, you know, overwhelmed healthcare systems. A lot of African Americans and Hispanic patients were much more likely to have, more likely to be hospitalized, have different types of needs around the time of COVID, which made clinic-based cardiac rehab particularly difficult for them. Maybe comfort, discomfort, and fear from that perspective, what kinds of patients were able to be seen or not seen around the time of COVID. And then you can see for home-based cardiac rehab, reimbursement was starting because of the whole telehealth and telemedicine revolution around the time of COVID. So less so outer setting issues, but most of the things that were driving home-based cardiac rehab were things related to a little bit of inner setting. You still need staff, you need exercise equipment and Wi-Fi. So thinking about the intersection of race and income here, of the kinds of people who need all the home, you need an exercise equipment, a whole bunch of stuff that were really focused on more of the kind of inner setting and motivation capability on the parts of patients and their providers. And so this is a really nice way of combining determinant frameworks to really understand some of the different drivers and maybe some of the different implementation strategies that are needed for these two types of evidence-based interventions. And so she's now testing a hybrid clinic and home-based intervention that addresses the barriers for all of these. So this is a nice kind of example of determinant frameworks. Next slide. So the next step is to create your strategy. You now know what the determinants are. We know that, you know, reimbursement is driving this, or maybe it's all behavior driving this. And so I actually learned this at the UCSF's implementation science certificate program like 7 years ago at this point. I've been using this framework for a very long time, and I really like it just because it really, this is now becoming a lot more popular, I think, in terms of really understanding the mechanisms by which your strategy is working or not. So in stage one, you're really understanding the behavior, thinking about all the determinants, just like we did. You can use CIFRA, you can use theoretical domains framework. So this is really, the BCW really does focus on the theoretical domains framework, which is a nice kind of, it's a synthesis of multiple theories and models, I think more than 100, and it synthesizes them all the way in just into 14 constructs, and then further into three larger overarching. So capability, I just didn't know, motivation, I don't want to do it, or opportunity, I don't have the resources to do this evidence-based intervention. And it very nicely maps those determinants to implementation strategies, to intervention functions that are theory-informed and different types of policy categories. So if it's all knowledge driving the barrier, that's your main barrier is all lack of knowledge, then you really need educational interventions. And it takes you through this appease criteria, really thinking about, is it acceptable, practical type of strategy? Would it worsen equity, for example? So if you're going to teach people through an electronic tool that's very hard for people who are lower income or don't have great digital literacy, then that might worsen equity, right, to some extent. And so it really systematically allows you to, takes you through identifying only those strategies that would meet all of these criteria and taking you through all the different types of behavior change techniques. So lots of ways to educate someone. You can demonstrate the behavior, you can model, et cetera. And increasingly, this is being, there's been some new data that you can map these to implementation strategies as well, which is what we've been doing for the last couple of years as well. Next slide. So as an example, another behavioral cardiology example for depression screening and treatment in cardiac patients, it's evidence-based. We know it improves outcomes. So we did a systematic review. So there's been some interest. I'm very much more focused on how to apply these frameworks. And we decided to do a systematic review because it would allow us to get a huge generalizable understanding of all the different barriers and facilitators to uptake and would then allow us to create a strategy that was a little bit more generalizable, but also focused on trying to improve its fit with the doing some user testing and also user-centered design to kind of improve fit as well. And so we found lots of barriers, and we've been starting to kind of innovate this model to use it at multiple levels, right? So what are all of the barriers from a COMB construct for providers? They also lack knowledge, they have lack time, but patients also lack knowledge. There's stigma and fear and all of these different types of barriers. And so we categorized all of these barriers using the COMB, which is based on the theoretical domains framework that I just spoke about. And this really allows you to really understand some of the drivers of why depression screening and treatment is so suboptimal. It's even lower than primary care. Only 6% of heart disease patients are on depression treatment for some reason. It's a marked evidence to practice gap. And so we got a very nice understanding of the multiple levels. So at the system level, provider level, and patient level. Next slide. And then put these into the behavior change technique, the behavior change wheel. And so what you can see here is that we really found a way to figure out the target behaviors of the system, the patient. Most for the patients, it's really knowledge, stigma, self-efficacy. For providers, it's really around memory and knowledge. And so we're able to create a multi-level equity-informed implementation strategy that really revolved around restructuring the environment, problem solving, some information and credible sources for the patients and for the provider's audit and feedback. And Rachel alluded to this as well, is that the need to really specify the proctor's implementation outcome that you're trying to target here. And so we thought our implementation, our problem solving meetings really would allow us to sustain this evidence-based intervention. The patient education would improve acceptability and fidelity on the parts of the patient. And then the patient preference report and decisional support would improve feasibility and fidelity on the parts of the providers. And so really combining frameworks here of the kind of outcome frameworks, proctor's outcomes, implementation outcomes, but also this trans-theoretical step-by-step behavior change wheel that allows you to create theory-informed implementation strategies. Next slide. The final example, so I gave you examples of how to use determinant frameworks, examples of how to use these kind of intervention development frameworks as well that are becoming much more popular if you want to design a strategy and understand how and why things worked. And then last is the process frameworks. I've been involved over the last couple of years in helping New York State implement collaborative care for depression. And so this is the piece framework that Rachel was alluding to earlier. This is a very, what these process frameworks allow you to do is to really think about the different constructs that are salient in even every stage of the implementation process. And so I came on in 2015, but in 2012, they were exploring what's the fit of this evidence-based intervention? Would it fit in New York State? And they were reviewing that it improves outcomes in racial ethnic minorities. It reduces costs. You know, it can offload the PCP. It's population-based approaches for providing depression treatment. Seems like a good fit. They started thinking about how are we going to pay for this at the state level, right? How will these were all from the perspectives of policymakers. So we're thinking about funding. Let's fund 32 academic clinics to pilot this and see what happens. Thinking about the organization, maybe this is a better fit in academic settings. They'd be more open. Thinking about partnerships, you know, this was on the part of the Office of Mental Health. They're like, let's, you know, partner with the Department of Health and partner with centers that can provide the technical assistance for us who know this program really well in other states. And then you go through your preparation phase where you're marketing and you're doing, I led all of the stakeholder interviews to understand amongst those pilot clinics, what were some barriers and facilitators to implementing this? And they had a ton. They're like, lack of resources. How are you going to sustain this? How are we going to pay for this? You know, the grant funding wasn't enough. Space considerations, you know, patient needs, there are strict criteria. Yes, you're helping our Medicaid patients, but how about our non-Medicaid patients? And so in 2015, they had a much more formal scale up and implementation process that I'm in the midst of looking at the cost effectiveness of this strategy, where they included technical assistance, they included, they expanded not just academic centers, but FQHCs and community and rural settings. For funding, now there was a fee for quality and service process. Using everything that they got from the exploration and preparation phase, they realized we're going to have to pay per patient that you enrolled in collaborative care and also pay for you if you actually could show quality. And there was also quality monitoring to help with fidelity, right? So they had to report back to the Office of Mental Health all of their fidelity metrics, how many patients were enrolled, how many patients were screened, how many patients improved who went through the program, which is very effective if you think about it in terms of improving outcomes and improving implementation overall and fidelity. And then, you know, other things started happening. Medicare started covering this, private insurers started covering this as other kind of, and so it became very clear they could focus on the Medicaid populations. And in the sustainability phase, this is where I've mostly focused my efforts, things were going on. Things were great in the beginning, but over time you have turnover of those great depression care managers who did such a good job of improving outcomes. Leadership starts thinking about other initiatives, COVID, other things come up. Maybe collaborative care is not as important anymore. You know, now you have patients who are very severe. This is a great program for less depressed patients. But so you can see how there are different constructs that are important at every single stage here. And things like fit become important again. You know, we had a lot of clinics who were like, forget collaborative care. This is just too hard. But understanding why they left are some of the things that I've been working on as well. Next slide. We're almost done. So we talked about determinant. We talked about, I added one on how to develop strategies. We talked about how process frameworks can be very helpful in terms of helping you plan and implement an evidence-based intervention. And so here's the evaluation framework that we use for REAIM. We're increasingly starting to include some equity constructs in this. And so they were able, these are claims, so we're able to have reach a fair number of patients, almost all racial and ethnic minorities, which is great. 2.5 million is all the Medicaid population. So not clear how many of those are actually depressed. And then from an effectiveness perspective, overall clinical improvement was about 44%. The original clinical trials were about 50%, which is not too bad. Improvement rates in terms of depressive symptoms amongst those reporting at least. And some of my data has shown that this strategy actually is cost saving from the payer's perspective over time. It makes sense for you to make sure that there's high quality, that people feel like this is not something that's going to bankrupt a healthcare system, right? And so you start seeing improvements in terms of cost, but also some social determinants of health that we're looking at as well, like insurance coverage. Patients who are part of this program were less likely to have their Medicaid lapse, which is a big kind of social determinant of health. We looked at adoption, not a huge, but overall 611 primary care clinics and counting across New York State express interest, and about 84% of them actually receive the technical assistance. So something else when you're thinking about this is really thinking about not just did I have my strategy, but did people participate in your strategy? Did your strategy actually happen when you rolled it out? And so you can see that different parts of the strategy were more effective. And so I won't go too much into this, but this really allows you to think about some mechanisms of what worked, what didn't. You know, things like training and knowledge and perceived fiscal barriers were much lower with this strategy. And what you start seeing are things like workflow and local setting types of issues that happen in the more sustainability phase. Next slide and final slide, hopefully. So what we're doing right now is focusing really on the sustainability. This was my first R01, thinking about ways in which we can add more behavior change to the dynamic kind of sustainability framework of thinking about sustainability behaviors, the fact that you have to get people to keep doing things. And so thinking about that a little bit earlier, and then really the part of the dynamic sustainability framework is that you need ongoing adaptation, ongoing quality improvement and change and user-centered design and everything else. And so we've started using user-centered design to kind of promote that adaptation as well. And so this is another example of maybe innovating some of the existing frameworks and including more theory and behavioral theory in existing frameworks as well that we have revised and resubmit at Implementation Science Communications. Last slide. And so I think hopefully I went through everything and synthesized a lot of what Rachel said in terms of the why or why not, how to develop, implement, and evaluate strategies and the ways in which frameworks can be very useful in taking you through that. Amazing. Rachel's going to go through resources. Great.
Yes. I love how you applied so clearly and comprehensively all of those theories, models, and frameworks. It's such rich examples. We wanted to share with you all, there are so many open access resources too that can help guide your work. Rachel Tabak and colleagues at Washington University have an amazing online kind of database that can help you identify theories, models, and frameworks. And to my heart's delight, they are updating this with a huge focus on health equity. There will be inclusion of both health equity-focused implementation research frameworks as well as health equity frameworks outside our field that can be applied. So super, super exciting. We also have a brief video library that Ross Brownson, Rachel Tabak, and I developed that has lots of videos that are free, brief and available, and many of them include information about theories, models, and frameworks if you're interested. And there's also, if you're writing a grant, a really excellent paper that Joanna Mullen and colleagues wrote on some recommendations for really applying these in the context of an implementation science grant. So that is another great resource. And we've put some references here, and we've covered a ton. So I know it's a lot to take in, but you have our information. We're always happy to answer questions or follow up. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Shelton and Moise. This was an outstanding presentation. We have just a couple of minutes, and I'd like to maybe in reflecting on the audience, in particular the early stage investigators, a question was surrounding the fact that you could have different aims in a grant with different models and frameworks, and sometimes within the same aim, several of them weaved in. And you had mentioned, Dr. Shelton, that having a nicely sort of weaved in framework throughout the grant has been really the recipe for success. Can you provide briefly some clarity surrounding that and maybe any other helpful hints that you may have?
Absolutely. So I think part of it is just being really clear and synergistic in your application. So in an implementation science framework, for example, you might have a whole aim just focused on engaging stakeholders to understand barriers and facilitators. And so that might be where one of the determinant frameworks come in. You might also be then using that to map on, you know, using something like EPIs or some of the, you know, theoretical domains framework to then guide what your implementation strategies are that you're testing. And then you might use something like REAIM or the Proctor model to inform your outcome. So that might come in your second aim. And then, you know, maybe even part of that within the grant, you might need to do some adaptation, cultural adaptation or contextual adaptation. So when you're describing your evidence-based intervention and how you're going to think about it, adaptation, you know, that piece might, you know, the adapted framework or something might come in. So it's very specific. It's not like you're just saying, we're going to use all these frameworks and here it is. You're very clear in how it's being integrated, citing it with the reference. It's really nice. We had that example of the knowledge to process model and how we use that, but it was very specific. Like, this is aim one. This is where we're bringing it in. This is how it's informing our design and measures and data collection. Here's aim two. This is where this piece is coming in. Here are the outcomes. This, you know, so it's integrated in the sections that are relevant, and it's very clear in terms of naming the frameworks that we're using to inform each stage and saying, you know what, this framework's not perfect for this setting. It's really missing the equity determinants. We're also going to bring in the health equity framework to supplement this. So, you know, researchers are okay with you using these combinations as long as you're providing that really clear rationale and you're making it clear it's synergistic and complementary.
Thank you very much for addressing this important question. And we are unfortunately out of time, but once again, we wanted to thank you both for this outstanding presentation, and for the audience, the recording of this session will certainly be available to you in about a week or so. If you have any additional questions, Rochelle has also provided her email address regarding this session. Thank you again for your attendance, and thank you, our presenters.
Thanks for having us. This was
great. Thank you. Bye, everyone.